Dear students, welcome to all of you. Today we are here to discuss structure and functions of secondary phloem. First, the gross structure and development of the phloem. Phloem is a complex conducting tissue of vascular plants. The term phloem was coined by Nageli in 1858 from Greek word for bark. The term leptome was used for phloem by Haberland in 1914. The phloem is a distinctive, important, and highly complex tissue solely responsible for the transportation of the food material from the source, that is leaves and storage organs, to the sink, that is regions of need. The phloem differentiated from procambium is called primary phloem, and that differentiated from vascular cambium is called secondary phloem. Primary phloem differentiates from provascular tissue and with primary xylem is a major component of stem vascular bundles, leaf traces, and the vascular systems of leaves, flower parts, fruits, and seeds. In roots of seed plants, it usually occurs in discrete bundles that alternate with ribs or bundles of primary xylem. In pteridophytes, primary phloem usually encloses either a central column or a cylinder of primary xylem. The primary phloem consists of protophloem and metaphloem. Protophloem differentiates earlier and nearer the apical meristem than protoxylem. The conducting elements are stretched and often obliterated. In protophloem, sieve tube members are without companion cells. Sieve tubes function for a brief period and soon they get crushed by the surrounding pressure and finally may disappear. Metaphloem differentiates later than protophloem in regions in which growth in length has ceased. Metaphloem tissue survives for a longer period. Its elements are longer and wider. Usually, fibers are absent in dicotyledons, whereas in monocotyledons and herbaceous dicots, parenchyma cells are absent. The conducting elements and associated cells of the primary phloem are remarkably similar to those of the secondary phloem in both structure and function. Now, the secondary phloem. The secondary phloem is derived from the vascular cambium and is composed of axial and radial systems of cells. The axial system is made up of conducting cells, associated parenchyma cells, companion cells in angiosperms, and phloem fibers. The radial system consists of phloem rays that are continuous with rays in the secondary xylem. The conducting cells longitudinally elongate are collectively called sieve elements. There are two types of sieve elements: sieve cells, characteristic of gymnosperms, pteridophytes, and other lower vascular plants, and sieve tube members, characteristic of angiosperms. These cells develop from sieve element mother cells, which are direct descendants of fusiform cambial initials. Following periclinal longitudinal divisions, the mother cells in gymnosperms differentiate into functional sieve cells, generally with little or no longitudinal, that is, intrusive growth. The mature sieve cells, like the fusiform cambial initials from which they are derived, are very long with overlapping ends. By contrast, in dicotyledons, transverse anticlinal and or oblique divisions in the sieve element mother cells lead to columns of superposed sieve tube members. Among the distinctive features of sieve elements is the fact that they comprise longitudinal, open, but living systems through which photosynthetes are transported. At maturity, The sieve element protoplast is highly modified, lacking a nucleus and vacuolar membrane, but it retains a functional plasma membrane and some parietal endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, and plastids. Another distinctive feature of sieve elements is the presence of sieve areas in the lateral walls of sieve cells and on the end walls, and in some taxa on lateral walls of sieve tube members. Sieve areas, which are highly specialized and evolutionarily modified primary pit fields, consist of groups of pores through which the protoplasts of contiguous conducting cells are connected. Pores in dicotyledons are often lined with cylinders of callose that enclose the plasma membrane, endoplasmic reticulum, and other cytoplasmic components that traverse the pores. Callose-lined pores have been reported in the nettles, but only rarely have been observed in other gymnosperms. In sieve tube members, sieve areas occur on end walls called sieve plates. A sieve plate containing a single sieve area is called a simple sieve plate, whereas one with several sieve areas is a compound sieve plate. Simple sieve plates usually occur on transverse end walls and compound sieve plates on oblique end walls. The sieve cells of gymnosperms and lower vascular plants do not have end walls. Sieve areas occur over the entire lateral walls, but often occur in greater frequency in the walls of the overlapping ends of the cells. Associated with the sieve tube members in the phloem of angiosperms are companion cells, many of which in the small veins of leaves are transverse cells that facilitate the loading of photosynthate into sieve tube members. Although several companion cells may be associated with a sieve tube member, each companion cell is derived from the same cambial initial as the sieve tube member with which it is in contact. Companion cells also accompany sieve tube members in the metaphloem of angiosperms, as well as the protophloem of some but not all species. In conifers, cells similar in function to the companion cells of angiosperms differ both in origin and morphology. These cells, called albuminous cells in the older literature, have in recent years been widely labeled Strasburger cells after the German botanist who first described them. They are derived largely from marginal ray cell initials as well as from some short fusiform initials, and generally are shorter than companion cells. Axial parenchyma cells are usually associated with strands of conducting cells, and in angiosperms are often difficult to distinguish from companion cells. Phloem fibers occur in longitudinal strands and appear in transverse sections as tangential and or radial strands in dicotyledons. Because during cambial activity, the secondary phloem is pushed outward and compressed, only the most recently formed annual increments are functional in transport. In these increments, the living conducting cells and the associated parenchyma cells are protected from compression by the surrounding masses of phloem fibers. In increments formed earlier, however, the forces resulting from the production of secondary xylem are so great that the sieve tube members, companion cells, and phloem parenchyma cells become severely compressed and non-functional in dicotyledons. Although in some conifers, for example, abies and pinus, the sieve cells become non-functional, the axial parenchyma cells resist the forces of compression, becoming repositories of phenolic compounds which provide a defense against invading insects and pathogens. This compression of the phloem explains in part why the annual increments of secondary phloem are so much less conspicuous than the growth layers of secondary xylem. Equally important is the fact that the cambium produces fewer phloem cells than xylem cells. The nature and development of the cell wall of sieve elements in both angiosperms and gymnosperms, with the exception of some members of the Pinaceae, the sieve elements have only primary walls, although the walls may be lamellate. Consisting of cellulose and pectic compounds, the sieve element wall is of variable thickness, often much thicker than that of associated parenchyma cells. Because of their glistening, pearly appearance in unkilled tissue, the term nacreous wall has been applied to walls of sieve elements. Now, the nature and function of P proteins. P proteins occur in both dicotyledonous and monocotyledonous, but are absent from gymnosperms and lower vascular plants. As observed with the electron microscope, P protein called psyllium in the older literature occurs in several forms, that is tubular, granular, filamentous, and crystalline. Aggregation of P protein into ellipsoidal or spheroidal P protein bodies occurs early in the differentiation of sieve cells. These bodies increase in size during differentiation of the cell and may fuse. Polyribosomes are associated with P protein filaments or tubules during aggregation and are thought to have a functional role in the process. Conspicuous crystals of P protein, commonly associated with tubular, filamentous or granular P protein, are characteristic of many members of Fabaceae. The small spheroidal bodies, previously thought to be extruded nucleoli, are now considered to be a type of P protein body. At about the time that the nucleus begins its disintegration, components of the P protein bodies begin to separate and to disperse within the protoplast. Although the function of P protein in sieve elements is not fully understood, it has been long observed that upon the release of internal pressure, the P protein moves suddenly in the direction of the pressure release to the ends of the cells and plugs the sieve pores. It has been shown recently that P protein crystalloids in legumes can undergo rapid reversible changes from the globular to the dispersed state in which they occlude the sieve pores. Dear students, now we will discuss the nature and functions of companion cells and Strasburger cells. The phloem accumulates photosynthate from the mesophyll of leaves, transport it throughout the plant, and releases it at sites where it is utilized in the growth and development of the plant. These functions are implied by the terms source, transport, and sink. The terms collection phloem, transport phloem, and release phloem has been proposed by Van Bell in 1996 to indicate more clearly these important functions of the phloem, but these terms are not as yet widely used. Each of these functions, that is collection, transport, and release of photosynthate, is intimately related to the structure and activity of companion cells associated with the sieve elements. Companion cells are derived from the same mother cells as the sieve tube members with which they are in contact. In contrast to the mature sieve tube members, the companion cell is characterized by a dense protoplast containing a prominent nucleus, many mitochondria, extensive rough endoplasmic reticulum, and abundant ribosomes, and plastids which in a few species have been observed to contain starch grains. The density of the protoplast increases throughout the differentiation of the cell, which also may become vacuolated. Companion cells in the collection phloem and transport phloem are relatively large in comparison with the sieve tube members. By contrast, they are small or entirely lacking in the release phloem. Companion cells and contiguous sieve tube members form sieve tube companion cell complexes. In collection phloem, companion cell in the venous of leaves function in the transfer of assimilators from photosynthetic tissues and bundle sheets into the sieve tubes. Because of their intimate association with sieve tube members, the companion cells also play an important role in maintaining the viability and long-distance translocation system of the enucleate sieve tube members by providing them with proteins, including information that is signaling molecules and ribonuclear protein complexes, as well as adenosine triphosphate. The structure of companion cells is directly related to the mode of phloem loading, that is, the method of movement of photosynthate from the companion cell into the sieve tube member. If symplastic, the companion cell wall will be traversed by numerous plasmodesmata. On the other hand, if phloem loading is apoplastic, the companion cell will have the structure of a transfer cell. In some symplastic loaders, the companion cells in the primary phloem are called vascular parenchyma cells or intermediary cells. Vascular parenchyma cells are specialized companion cells that function either as intermediate providers to other cells or by transferring photosynthate directly into contiguous sieve tube members. Autonomy of the sieve element companion cell complexes is especially important in the transport phloem in stemmas, where many plasmodesmata between the complexes and adjacent parenchyma cells appear to be closed. This presumably prevents leakage from the sieve tube companion cell complexes into surrounding tissues, thus maintaining solute concentration sufficient to ensure pressure flow through the system and ensuring nutrition to terminal and axial sinks along the stem, such as the cambial zone. In the release phloem, that is sinks, where there may be no companion cells, there is a symplastic transfer of assimilates directly from the sieve tubes into the adjacent parenchyma. As in grasses and some other monocotyledons, diverse pathways also characterize photosynthetic transport in dicotyledons. Although of similar function, the Strasburger cells of gymnosperms differ in origin and structure from the companion cells of angiosperms. Most are highly specialized marginal ray cells in contact with sieve cells. Like the protoplast of the companion cells, that of Strasburger cells has very dense protoplasm containing abundant ribosomes, extensive rough endoplasmic reticulum, numerous mitochondria, plastids, which may contain starch grains, and a prominent nucleus, which may be lobed. Also, a large vacuole may develop. The protoplasts of Strasburger cells and adjacent sieve cells, like those of companion cells and sieve tube members, are connected through sieve area pores in the walls of the sieve cells and extensive plasmodesmata in the contiguous walls of the Strasburger cells. The Strasburger cells are also connected to ray parenchyma cells by numerous plasmodesmata, most probably facilitating the translocation of solutes from the rays into the sieve cells by way of the Strasburger cells. Dear students, now we will discuss the mechanism of transport in the phloem. According to the widely accepted pressure flow hypothesis proposed by the German botanist Ernst Mach in 1927, the movement of solutes within the sieve tubes is essentially passive, the result of hydrostatic pressure developed osmotically along gradients established by the presence of high concentrations of sugar near the source of photosynthate and lower concentrations in the vicinity of sinks, that is, areas of use or storage. The loading and unloading of sugars is essential for the establishment of a high solute concentration and a pressure gradient, and ultimately for the transport of photosynthate and other substances throughout the plant. Photosynthate is produced largely in the leaves and transported predominantly downward to sites of utilization and or storage in the stems and roots. But photosynthate and growth hormones are also transported to regions of active primary growth in buds and the tips of stems distal to the sites of photosynthate production. This hypothesis envisages an essentially open system whereby photosynthate is moved from cell to cell through the sieve pores. Because of the presence of large quantities of P protein on the sieve plates as seen by electron microscopy, the concept of a passive flow through the sieve area pores has been severely criticized. Peterson and Currier in 1969 demonstrated that translocation in the phloem is bidirectional, although they found no evidence of bidirectional translocation within individual sieve tubes. Their research made an important contribution to the knowledge that in major axes of the plant, photosynthate moves predominantly toward the base of the plant from sugar sources, but also in the direction of developing tissues and organs just below the apical meristem. Translocation in the phloem is also bidirectional in developing leaves, which, when very young, import photosynthate from the more mature regions of the plant. Thus, movement of photosynthate in the developing leaf is bidirectional at an early developmental stage, moving toward the leaf tip and later moving toward the leaf base. Now, the functions of secondary phloem. The chief function of phloem is the conduction of elaborated foodstuffs, both proteins and carbohydrates, and possibly with mineral nutrients. The sieve elements are believed to be the cells concerned in this conduction, with the companion cells or the albumin cells related in some way to their activities. The sclerenchymatous tissue, that is, fibers and sclerides, serve in support of organs and protection of soft underlying tissues. Many parenchyma cells serve as storage cells for crystals, various organic materials at certain periods. Others perhaps serve in conduction of some substances. Some are crystal storage regions. At last, we will discuss the economic value of secondary phloem. Fibers of secondary phloem were formerly used commercially to a considerable extent and are still of some importance. The secondary phloem of various trees and shrubs of the Malvaceae, Tiliaceae, Moraceae, etc. has provided bast or bast fibers for economic purposes for centuries. Other uses of phloem are as a source of tannin, as in oak, chestnut, and hemlock bark, and together with the cortex as a source of some spices and drugs, for example, cinnamon and quinine. The secretory canals are often abundant in phloem, and the secretions may be of much economic value, as are rubber, which is obtained from the latex of hevea and other genera, and various resins such as kusuri gum obtained from agathis and spruce gum from picea. Dear students, this is all about structure and function of secondary phloem. Dear students, we have discussed over here gross structure and development of phloem, nature and function of P protein, and mechanism of transport in the phloem. We have also discussed the functions and economic value of secondary phloem. Thank you very much. God bless you.